Well, I guess everybody's, I'm George Gilder. I guess everybody senses that this is going to be a real debate. I went to a bunch of debates, and they all wimped out so far today. So I expect these debaters to really engage each other, and we'll have some incandescence here. And opening this debate on U.S. foreign policy is Ron Paul. And Paladin of liberty and constitutional policy, and an eloquent voice for libertarian values.
Ten minutes. Give a warning then. Thank you very much. Good to be back. Good to visit with you this morning. I did talk about foreign policy a bit. And I've been talking a lot about foreign policy over the last 6 months. Matter of fact, over the last decade or two, I have been talking about foreign policy. To me, it's not a complicated issue. If you look at the traditions of this country, it really was built on a non-interventionist foreign policy. And that is built on our Constitution, because it did not give permission, the Constitution has not given permission for us to so-called police the world or spread our goodness, our so-called goodness. Everything changed at the beginning of the last century, and in particular in 1914 with Woodrow Wilson, with his idealistic notion that through force you can spread our democracy around the world. Although the people weren't ready for it, those demagogues who got control of our government were able to persuade the people. And when you think about it throughout the 20th century, those individuals that advocated non-interference and non-intervention generally won the election, almost always. So it was Wilson who was contriving us to get into World War I all along in 1916, won on, I'm going to keep us out of the war. And also, FDR, likewise in 1940, although Europe was in a blaze already, he promised to keep American boys at home. So that was our tradition. That was the American feeling of non-intervention and neutrality and minding our own business. We were taking the advice of the founders who said, don't get involved. And quite frankly, the Constitution doesn't permit it. The Constitution does talk about war, and it says that if need be, the war should go ahead only with a declaration of war. One of the prime reasons of removing the control of foreign policy from the executive branch and this power to declare war was because of the oppression of the king, and they wanted to take it away from the executive branch. And they were explicit in saying that the Congress, that body that was closest to the people, would have the say, that we would not go to war. And the purpose of this is to go to war rarely. And when you do, you go with a consensus, and you go with the idea that you will go and win the war and get it over with. Even though we got into wars, especially World War I, which was essentially the cause of World War II, the wars at least were declared. But after World War II, once we had started to give up our concept of national sovereignty and came in under the United Nations, we went to war hardly with a blink from the Congress by going to war in Korea without a declaration. The strongest opponents at that time were the old right conservative Republicans who opposed this. And yet, we ended up in Korea undeclared, and the war wasn't won. We drifted once again because we rejected the notion of non-intervention. We ended up going into Vietnam, and we lost that war. We are achieving so much more now in peace than we ever were able to achieve in war. We went over there to tell them how to live and make sure that they were westernized and we had control. It was a total failure. Since we lost in Vietnam, we have followed more the advice of the founders, and the founder says non-intervention, don't fight with people, have free trade, talk to people, trade with people, go back and forth, but don't get involved in their internal affairs. It's good advice. It was good advice then. It's great advice today. I wish we would follow it. But there are a lot of shortcomings from interventionism. One, it usually never, even though there are always justifications for it, always the good justification, inevitably there are unintended consequences, all bad. And there is this principle that we talked about in the debates next called blowback. And when you interfere and get involved in other countries and you do it long enough, you're finally going to aggravate them. And that is what happened. All I'd like to suggest is that if you have a little bit of difficulty in accepting a total non-interventionist foreign policy, always see it through the light of a political aspect of looking upon it, what it would be like if we were receiving the same treatment. What would we think if the Chinese were over here and they had their navy in the Gulf of Mexico and they had troops on our land and they were teaching us to live like the Chinese and teaching us about their religion and their laws? We would be outraged, and we would fight, and we would do anything. And yet we go over complacently thinking that all we have to do is go over there, and we are going to westernize that region. Now, I have used the quote from Ronald Reagan that he had a lesson he learned in a difficult situation. He sent troops in the early 1980s to Lebanon. I was in the Congress at the time and spoke out strongly against it. And he, at the time, when he sent the troops, he said, "One thing, I'll never turn tail and run." Before you know it, the Marines were killed, and Reagan took the troops out. And then he explained this in his biography. And he said, Reagan said, "I would never turn tail and run." But finally, after he realized the irrationality of the politics and the hatreds of that region, we changed our policy there. And that's a down-to-earth lesson, and he learned it. But we didn't learn it. And here we are still, proposing that we go over and get involved overseas. In a practical sense, we've been involved for a long time. World War I, we shouldn't have been in it. We were demanding a spot at the table in the Versailles Treaty. The Versailles Treaty led literally to World War II. And also, those boundaries that exist after the Ottoman Empire broke down, the boundaries of the Middle East, drawn up by the West, Europeans and Americans. And we're still fighting over those artificial boundaries. And then in 1953, it was decided that democracy was not for the Iranians. Now we're dying to spread democracy, but the Iranians have an election, elect Mohammad Mossadegh, who also was a physician, and we didn't like him because he was serving the interests of the Iranians and attacking the foreign interests of the British and the American Petroleum Company. So he was standing up for his people. So what do? We throw him out of office through the CIA. And we wonder why they get angry and upset. So when did the blowback come? Probably not till 1979. After 25 years of the Shah, they get a bit annoyed, but they don't forget. We remember nothing, they forget nothing. So this helped precipitate the growth of the radical Islamists. Matter of fact, we literally in the 80s subsidized the madrasa schools. The radical Islamists, because we thought, oh, this will be good. We need radicals because they're going to attack the communists. And besides, Osama bin Laden is our friend. And we're fighting for him because he's a freedom fighter. I mean, the absurdity of the intervention is just unbelievable that people still accept it. Because it always has negative consequences. And it goes on and on and on. We were partners with Saddam Hussein. Matter of fact, we were his allies. Said, go get Iranians. Invade Iran. So he did, and of course, he was a bad guy, and he used terrible weapons. He used gas. But where did he get the gas? From us. It has to stop, and it can't stop by having a better managed war in Iraq. Those who are changing their opinion, and they're changing their opinion in droves today on Iraq, and it's not because we have mismanaged the war, it is because we have a bad foreign policy. We have a foreign policy that endorses interventionism. We need a foreign policy which is constitutional, conservative, wise, and that is a policy of non-intervention. We ought to stay at home, mind our own business, trade with people, and be friends with people, and we all would be a lot better off.
Very effective, man. Very effective.